Very interactive session. Don't make me and him. This is Santosh, by the way. I'm Hi. Satya. So don't make us just talk. You can bring up any point you want.
Your thoughts.
So whatever you have to say, please feel free to say it. So we are, I'm not an Android developer by any means. So he knows a bit of Android development.
I'm just starting into Android development stuff.
So I'm an Android enthusiast. I like to do what we call experiment and tinker. I don't like having this sitting like this. What I want to know is how I can push this phone to its maximum extent. So to start off, try it out. So when you get your Android phone out of the box, this is how it will look like if you're on the latest KitKat. ICS and below will have different versions, etc. And this is how your lock screen will look like, right? So what I intend to show you if we are, so what we are trying to do is, we're trying to connect to our phone so that we can show you how our phones look like and what you can do to do that. But before we get to that, we are trying to fix that issue first. But have you guys done anything to your Android phones? Or do you have installed any apps or what special apps do you use?
Apps, obviously.
Let us ignore the Angry Birds 2048, all of these things. Tell me some app which you think you have installed, which changes Android in a way that you never thought it would. And yes, please. Your name?
Zupa.
Your name, please?
I'm Parag.
Okay. What is Zupa?
Zupa is a, it's a widget.
Okay.
So I can create my own widget.
Okay.
So I can create my clock, calendar, the way I want.
Okay. So I'm not a huge widget fan, by the way, but I have some super essential widgets, like one widget for controlling iTunes from anywhere. So it connects, it remote connects to my iTunes library. I have another widget for controlling my Plex Media Center. So I can connect to it, I can essentially stream to my phone, or I can use my phone as a remote control for Plex. I don't have to be near my Media Center. Any other systems that you guys use? Come on.
What about launchers? Do you guys use custom launchers? Go Launcher, Nova,
Go Launcher.
Right?
I use Nova.
Oh, you're on KitKat.
Sorry?
KitKat?
The Google Experience Launcher. What phone do you have? The Google Nexus 5?
No.
Oh, iPod. All right, you're using that on the iPod?
iPod.
Oh, iPod.
Sorry.
Is it where they're giving free Android phones?
Yes. Free Android phones for all. Provided you can help us, you know, fix this problem we have been making.
BlueStack.
So
Because BlueStack launcher
problem
sucks.
Connecting.
Yeah, but I think I have a better alternative to that. Jenny Motion.
Yeah.
So this is my 2 days old phone. I used to use basic phone. But I've been using on Jenny Motion WhatsApp.
Mm-hmm.
And it was pretty fast.
Mm-hmm.
BlueStack actually sucks.
So
this is a little different. What we are trying to do is tell you guys that there's more to customization than just, you know, installing a custom launcher, changing the theme and such.
See, the most basic level, what people would do is install a launcher, something like Aviate, for example. Aviate is what they call a smart launcher. It was recently purchased by Yahoo. So what Aviate does is, based on the time of the day, based on your previous past, at that time, let's say that at 4 o'clock you call your wife or your girlfriend or your spouse or fiance or whoever it is. So it remembers that. So at 4 o'clock you'll get a message saying it's perhaps it's time to call whoever it is. We have an Indian company called Dixtera.
Yeah, okay.
They are a Bangalore based or Kochi based company. Their app called Friday, which kind of mimics the same thing. And I think they were here like 2 years ago with the same technology.
But there's some dialer which based on the Friday, which
they've used Friday technology to extend to some other things. Here comes the merrymaker, troublemaker. So the thing is, like, I've used Friday on and off basis. But the thing is, like, I found it very clunky, very slow, very battery draining. Sorry to any Friday developers here, but that's how your app is. So I never use it more.
Actually, it's better now, but it's still, you know, it's still. Are you comfortable sharing your data, your life, to a third-party user, third-party, you know, provider? Everything is available on their servers, so I wasn't comfortable with that.
So that was Friday, and then. I talked about Aviate.
But if you're on social network, you are sharing something.
Yeah, let's not get into the privacy and this thing altogether. That's a whole different can of worms to open. Okay? So. Right. That is that. Anything else? Any other app that you use which transforms your Android phone? Have you heard of geofencing?
Yeah, absolutely.
You are a special guest. Anyone else? Sir, technical architect of Admir, please. Please. Ah, Muttu. So, geofencing is a technique where you associate a location to a specific task. For example, if you are at your house, switch to Wi-Fi automatically. You can use things like this. So this is what we try to demonstrate. So I am going to start off with an application which I started using almost 2 years ago. So this app is called Llama, location profiles, as it's called. So what it does,
Llama,
yes, double L-A-M-A. Okay, so so Llama location profile. So what you can do with this app is, you can train Llama to say that my office is, it doesn't use GPS, it can covers, is covered by these cell towers, okay? And when you enter the area, or when you exit the area, it can do things. When you enter your office location, it automatically puts your phone to silent mode. When you exit it, it puts it to normal mode. Now think about this, every day, day in, day out, I used to go to office, I used to keep my phone on the desk, I used to get called into my daily meeting, deep in a discussion of some pressing issue, my phone starts ringing or some notification comes up. How annoying would that be? Instead of that, not have something which does it automatically for you. So this is one such app which does that. Very handy tool. It initially started off using location services based on location info. You can extend it to do a lot more things. Like I have it to, I hate auto-rotate on my Android phone because it's not very precise. I tilt it a little bit, especially when you're sleeping and you want to read, you tilt it a little bit, it rotates the entire thing. And there are some very nice apps which thinks that if you rotate, it must fetch the data again, refreshes the entire thing. It drives me insane. So what I do is, I have disabled auto-rotation. But in Llama, I have said, when the foreground app is gallery, auto-rotate should be enabled. Think about how simple that is. Think about the quality of life that improvement has brought in. Right? So you no longer have to go settings, auto-rotate on, off. Of course, there are quick settings which you can do, which we'll try to demonstrate a bit later. But you don't have to do all of these things. When your phone can do it, why not let it do it? These are the things that we start off with. Llama location profiles. And a much, much more advanced version is Tasker, which is so complex, you can put two rocket scientists and they still can't figure out how to fix that thing. There are tutorials which run into 4 or 5 pages. You run there, you read that entire tutorial, and you'll find doing differentiation or integration to be much, much easier. So it's kind of that complex. Or at least it is to me. I don't know about you guys. I don't know if you tried it or not. But if you think this is complex, just have a look at Tasker. The first thing it will do is, it'll ask you, what variable do you want to set? You'll be like, Right, so. That's the reason why I don't use Tasker. I actually bought Tasker at a sale. For some reason, why I don't know, I thought I'll try it. I opened it, closed it in 2 minutes, and never opened it again. I uninstalled it. I don't know why I bought it in the first place, but, you know, sale behavior. Something's on sale, buy it. So, got it? All right. So, good thing is we are back on track.
bring it inside.
Phones, what they think about is custom ROMs. How many of you have heard of custom ROMs? Ah, that's a really poor response. I expected a lot more to hear about custom. Have you heard of Cyanogen? Cyanogen mod. Cyanogen mod is what we call a custom ROM or Linux distro for Android.
You're talking about ROMs?
Yes. I'm down with fever, cold, so my throat is all fucked.
Sorry.
So, custom ROM is essentially they take Android from their source code, AOSP project, they add in effects, they add in little tweaks of their own, they bundle it, they package it, they launch it. Right? So, what's the problem with custom ROMs? A, you are expected to use a piece of software which is written by a bunch of guys doing it in their free time. I don't mean it in a very disparaging manner, but the thing is, when you have limited time to work on something, you will get around to using hacks. I am a programmer, I use hacks all the time, but the thing is, like, when you use hacks, it's not production quality. There's a reason, and they can get away with it. They put a disclaimer. Custom ROM, use at your own risk, we are not responsible, whatever, done. But I have this, the worst problem I had is like, I was waiting for a call from my interviewer, I was applying in a few places. I got a call from an interviewer, I answered the phone, I was using a custom ROM that time, I had an Nexus S. I answered the call, phone rebooted.
So what he's trying to say is custom ROMs don't give you that kind of custom, you know, stability that, you know, a stock Android ROM would give you.
Stock Android or Android releases, you may say that they are buggy, but still for 99% of user cases, they are very stable, right? I mean, you don't talk about battery leaks mainly on stock ROMs. I mean, there are few cases here and there, but they're generally attributed to bad applications rather than the OS itself. So that is custom ROM. And the thing is, you have to go through this entire whole ritual of, you know, preparing your phone and this and that. So it's, for a geek like me, it's like, you know, it's like Christmas. You got a lot of candies, like, ooh, I'm going to dig into this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. So it's a lot of fun. But imagine doing that. Imagine doing that being done by somebody else.
The problem is the driver will not associate properly.
Exactly.
Your sound quality will go down. You need to put a lot of drivers to improve your sound quality.
Exactly.
I'm like every day I was like installing.
This fellow is probably one of those guys who would reflash his phone with a new ROM every other day.
So buys a new phone every 6 months. So.
Yeah, let's not get to that either. So.
I already bricked one phone.
Oh, that's the way you learn. That's the way you learn. I had a Nexus 1, almost bricked it. Then I shifted
to
a Nexus 4.
That's still sitting in my drawer.
You don't know the Nexus 1?
You don't know how to bring it back.
So that means
you
phone is gone instead,
No, usually
it depends
you can always
on
get it
what
back.
You did. It
yeah.
depends on what you did.
A soft bricking, you can get it back. But if you hard brick your phone, then it's dead.
Generally, most of the time you get into boot loops. It's when... It's the equivalent of your computer rebooting over and over again. So with that, you can bring it back to life, so that's not a problem. The biggest problem is, if something goes wrong and it wipes out your bootloader, then you're dead. Your phone is bricked. So that's probably what happened. If your bootloader is a piece of software which actually starts your Android. So at a specific location on the flash, there are a set of instructions which say, see, when you go to a new town, you don't know where to go, what to do. So what do? You go, you ask a nearby guy, hey, how do I go here? He'll tell you instructions, go here. That's essentially what a bootloader does. When a phone starts, it doesn't know what to do. It goes there, it reads that instruction, goes there, it reads that instruction. Now, if that first instruction itself is not there, what do? You're marooned, you're lost, right? Yeah?
Is there any way to secure your bootloader, like the new Windows 8.1? As a secure boot, so you can't touch that bootloader. Is there any way to do that for Android?
Most
Android phones actually come that way.
Okay.
You know, the bootloader is secure. You can't actually hack into them. Okay. But we want it to be insecure, right? So that you can make your customizations and all that.
We are talking about different things, I think.
I'm sure what he's talking about, Windows 8 bootloader, is a bit different, but I'm trying to, you know,
in an analogy,
it to,
it's like,
yeah. So,
you obviously can break it.
But yeah, these days, it's not cool to have a locked bootloader. That's why if companies like HTC and obviously all your Nexus phones come with a very easily unlockable bootloader. It's one simple command. Just install your fastboot into your PC, connect your phone, and then fastboot, OEM, unlock bootloader. That's it. And you're done. Yeah.
So, there a way to modify what is in your bootloader? So that if you bring your phone, if I'm saying,
So
can't you modify it? Like
yeah, so instead of modifying your bootloader, you won't go there. You'll install something called as a custom recovery. Right? A custom recovery, I'll try to show it. I'm not sure whether you'll be able to. So there you can install custom ROMs, flash your phone, and then completely wipe
your
phone, back up your phone, and then restore it to any. It's like system recovery or how you have it on Windows XP, Windows 7. So it's basically that for your whole operating system. So that's
where bootloader is at a place where which cannot be modified. So that's why we have to get around these things.
If you don't want to get into all these things, you know, it's a bit geeky for many. If you're, of course, into Android and into customizing, hacking, and everything, yes, you'll love this. You'll love it. It's a challenge and everything. But for simple people, it's a simple command: fast boot, OEM, unlock. That's it. You're done. You're ready. You get a simple file. It's called the Super SU file. You put it into your phone. You reboot it. You flash it. You're done. You have super user on your or admin rights on your phone. It's called rooting your phone, right? Once you've rooted your phone, you can do a lot of things. If you observed, my phone is Google Nexus 5.
We'll get to that.
Okay, so you want to talk
Exposed first. So that's the reason why I don't prefer custom ROMs. They're kind of too unstable for my liking, and I prefer my phone software to be vetted by the guys who did it, actually. So what I discuss later might seem like hypocrisy, but you'll understand that. But anyway, so instead of using custom ROMs, there is a piece of software called Exposed Framework. Have any of you heard of Exposed?
Have you?
1, 2, 3. Okay. So
great. So first things, this is a default Nexus 5. Mine is a Nexus 5. Not much of modifications. If you look at it, do you see any modifications? Can anybody tell you? Can you guys tell me if it's been modified? It looks stock, right? It looks just like how your any other regular Nexus 5 looks like,
this?
Except this part.
See this? Do you see this?
This is the overflow button that you had in Android 2.3 and everything, and this and this are interchanged. This has a small shortcuts key which brings up your calculator and stuff.
Can
just
you
look
show
at this.
My phone?
Yeah.
So the shortcut screen was moved around or something?
No, I've customized it. There are no shortcuts. Have you seen your default Android? There's only three buttons, right? Back, home, and then the multitasking button. That's it. So
it's
what
other
I...
Way around.
Sorry?
Which he's displaying.
Yeah.
It's other way around. Like order.
Yeah, I've changed it. I've changed it to my liking.
HTC,
we have. Yeah, I was always a HTC user, so I've gotten used to it.
Can you show my phone for a bit?
So this is how a Google Nexus, this is the Google Nexus launcher. I'm not using any special launcher, no Nova or Go Launcher Pro.
In a minute you'll see how my phone is, which is, well, just might drive you crazy or might think, is this guy insane or what?
But talk about Android Exposed.
So yeah, so what we do is we use a tool called Exposed Framework. The first big disadvantage of Exposed Framework is that it requires root access because of the way it does. What Santosh explained right now, put the SU super user root, super user binary, flash it, relaunch it, so that's essentially giving you root access. Root access is because by default Android prevents, it's got a lot of restrictions for security purposes, so it prevents a user from doing any activity or any running any process at an unprivileged level. So what Exposed does is it sits in place between Android and the application.
So it sits somewhere over here. So what it does, whatever commands the application sends, it reads it, it passes it. So what does it do? It gives you, this is how my Nexus 4 looks like. Can you imagine that this is Android?
That's not a custom launcher.
It is a custom launcher plus some extra tweaks of my own.
So that's the advantage of Android, right? You can customize it to your liking. So I don't exactly like having 8 icons on the desktop, you know, and such.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These are the most commonly used applications that I use. Then I have further grouped them according to, you know, social utilities, imaging, news, etc., etc. So these are the ones which I use the most. So I don't have to open my app drawer at all. Anything, I just click and launch it. If there are any other apps which I very rarely use, I just type it over there in the launcher, search it, and bam.
If you observe the top, this is a stock Android ROM. But look at the top, and you can see that there's a charging, you know.
You can see the blue bar there at the top. That's my battery bar. That indicates battery percentage.
Was it chart? The pie chart.
That's the another battery one, so experimenting, I need to get rid of that.
So. I won't show them
it. It does, it does. It does lag, so just okay. Start using.
One second.
Satya,
huh?
I did disclaimer. Everything is at your own risk.
So this is my lock screen. As you can see.
Battery.
You, if you use Android phones, you know how fast your battery runs out. At least for me, it does. So, I am a pretty heavy user. So, then, yeah, sorry. Quick settings, again, completely revamped. This is something which we use using Expose.
You can add whatever you want. You can add a calculator there as a shortcut.
Every user has a 2G data.
He's on Wi-Fi.
I'm on Wi-Fi right now. I have a exposed module which switches it to 2G whenever my phone is off, whenever the phone screen is off for more than 5 minutes. That is why it showed 2G. If I switch it on and if the screen is on for more than 3 minutes, it switches back to 3G. So that is why it's showing 2G.
I have a doubt.
Yeah.
I'm from English of Science. We are doing a number cycle sharing application.
Okay.
So basically, we are running this app on this Android app. So what happens is, if somebody wants to take a cycle, he does this. He just have this NFC card, just touch it,
right.
Then take.
Absolutely,
cycle.
NFC is
so
what.
Yeah, NFC.
Yeah.
So I have kept some people who are going to rent the cycle. So it's semi-automatic. So what thing is, I don't want the people who are sitting there using standard phone. I mean, if I give them access to internet, they will browse something.
Mm-hmm.
So how do I prevent it? So I want only one app to be ready. When I boot, I don't want the other apps to be there.
So how
do I make, can I use this Expose to just allow one application?
See, with Expose, you have something like how you have with Windows, wherein you can run an app on startup, right? So you can do that. But I'm not really sure how you can block everything out, everything else out.
Android OS and the application layer. And Expose can do method rewriting. So those who are in programming know what method rewriting means. It intercepts. So if your application says, draw this piece of rectangle, Expose can intercept that and make convert that rectangle into a pentagon. So that's essentially how you get all these modifications. That's at a very high level of how Expose works. I won't get into detail of it because it's way too complicated.
So
Expose by itself it's nothing. It's just a framework. Okay, so what Expose brings is there are a lot of modules which are like your pluggable things. Each of these modules has their own specific features here and there. Satosh will explain.
So yeah, as Satya told you guys that, you know, you want a specific app to rotate and nothing else to rotate at the same time. So what you can do is use Llama. Llama, of course, has a bit of, you know, a learning curve as well, but it's much simpler with Expose. Let me get to it. Say I want YouTube to rotate. I want only YouTube to rotate. I do not want to switch on my rotate settings. As you can see here, the rotate settings are locked. Yeah, that's my, yeah. See, the rotation is locked. But I have this setting. There's this app called App Settings. So basically you can just go to that app. You'll see a list of all your applications. Open the application that you want and switch on the customizations. You have a lot of options here, DPI, font scaling, screen size, locale, full screen, and then here something called orientation. So I've set it as force auto rotation. So when I open up the YouTube app, I can automatically rotate it and my rotation settings still remain. So when you're using WhatsApp and you see you're, you know, sleeping and texting, it doesn't rotate. So there's a bit of a lag, I'm sorry, because we're using USB. We initially wanted to use something called WebKey. WebKey is another internet-based, or rather Wi-Fi.
It's actually a LAN-based software. It's essentially equivalent to running a VLC server on your phone. So if you use remote desktop, you know how it is. You can remote to your system. So I can remote to my phone from my PC itself. It shows a display of the system. I wanted to demonstrate using WebKey, but it was not possible.
Also, if you observe my desktop, the icons look smaller. The default Nexus 5 has huge icons, you know, it's a real turn-off. But see, look at mine, it's a little bit smaller, more organized, and I'll just show you how that's done. I'm using the Google Now Google Experience Launcher, right? So I'll open up the Google Search app. That's what the Google Experience Launcher is tied with. And there's something called DPI. So the default DPI is 480. Makes your screen look, and the icons look huge. So I can just say 360, and everything just makes, it goes down to a smaller level. Basically, you're trying to fit in more information in the same screen.
And some of these custom ROMs have this thing called phablet mode, where you can force some applications to open in a phablet mode. Phablet is phone plus tablet, or tablet mode.
Yeah,
Android is the most famous of the lot which does that. So what they do is they use the same thing. They change the DPI. They allow you to change the DPI, so customize the DPI. For example, you can say that I want Google Maps always to be in phablet mode. Gives you a different UI, so especially if you have huge screens, 5 plus inch screens, then some applications look better in phablet mode. Gmail, for instance, or Google Maps, for instance, they look better with the phablet mode.
Initially, you needed a custom ROM like Paranoid Android, but now with Expose, you can just do it with one tap of a button.
The whole advantage of Expose is you don't have to install a custom ROM for just one feature. Or my other biggest problem I had with custom ROM was there are n number of custom ROMs and not a single custom ROM had all the features that I wanted, which was driving me insane. If I use CM, I won't get Paranoid Android's phablet mode. If I use Paranoid Android, I won't get some of CM's features. So things like that.
And then there are things like Wallet, which is if you're only in the US, you can use Wallet, right? A lot of things like this, which are only custom locale-based apps. But I want to still use Wallet. I can keep track of the transactions I've made online. So this is how you can do it. It's called the locale, and I've set it as English, United States. And that's it. Save it, and you have Wallet on your phone. It automatically comes back on your lock screen, and you can use Wallet. So that's one way.
I think that's the locale of your account.
Yeah, but my locale is India, right? So
yeah,
you can trick it into thinking that you're actually in the US. And you'll get Wallet in your app drawer.
So we'll move on to some of the most popular mods that Expose modules. So these three are the most commonly ones. Gravity Box, XUI mod, and XBlast. Okay, so out of this, I would say that you probably need only Gravity Box, because
Gravity Box will give you everything.
That's
every
like
little change that we have done, including the navigation bar and how Satya showed you the tiles and everything. You can change everything here.
And if you notice, my navigation, it had pixelated these things. It did not have these icons. It was back home written in pixels. So that was not in Gravity Box. That was using XUI mod.
So you have all these options. Say you want to go to display options, there's something called expanded desktop. That's something I really like. You can just say expanded desktop and then gone. Your navigation bars will go. So when you're playing a game, you know, you get the navigation bars, it's a little bit of a hindrance, right? You wouldn't like it. So there you go. So you might be wondering how you navigate now. If you've heard of Pi Controls, it's back. It's back here again. You don't need a custom ROM again.
just like this. You can swipe from the bottom of the screen and it comes up. Not sure why this is. Yeah, that's how it comes up. So with your finger, just swipe wherever you want to whichever button. Press the home, press the back, you're done.
Just to add on, if somebody is working on an enterprise and want to, the default email will be password protected and it will force you to password protect your email client.
Mm-hmm.
And the,
yeah.
And if you want to like disable everything, you can do it. This is very easy. Disable the 7-digit password that enforces the email client.
So happy.
Also, Satya showed you something with the lock screen. So the lock screen, it showed you the battery usage and everything. I go a step further. I enforce a full screen lock screen. So usually your lock screen is this button is here, right? But with the expanded mode, the button moves down. You get a lot more space. With this is dash clock that I'm using. It's a widget. Yeah. So basically, if you get notifications, hangouts, messages, everything, they keep showing up here. And I want more. I keep adding custom applications and they all show up till here. I get more screen space. And then, it's scrollable too. But, you know, with one go, you can just look at everything if you have the whole screen.
Like, if you have many widgets, you can scroll.
Yeah. And then, mine shows the battery as well. But then I have all these extra little applications that I can just go do right from the lock screen. There's a Barcamp app, which I can just swipe down
nice.
And it goes to the Barcamp app.
Which application is this?
Gravity Box. The same Gravity Box has this.
So okay. Most of the changes can be done using Gravity Box. So
absolutely.
So all the changes that you've done is using Gravity Box.
Majority of them are using Gravity Box. Some things here and there. Like for example, if you use the Nexus 4, you know the power button is of very bad quality and mine is almost dead. So if I have to unlock it, right, it doesn't get unlocked. I have to punch it like 4-5 times. I got annoyed with that.
Okay.
So I use XUI mod to remap my volume down to the power. So if I want to unlock it, I press the volume down, it unlocks it. If I hold volume down, then it reduces the volume. Right?
Nice.
So
you can remap.
You can remap
buttons.
Remap buttons.
Also,
sorry?
Yeah.
You can remap buttons also.
Yes. And to, for,
awesome.
And what I have also done is, if I double tap my status bar, phone gets locked. No need to press the button.
Or you can do you can have something like what I do.
Or,
the back arrow, I just long press it and it switches off.
See how many customization options we have. This is something which we like about Android. You are not, you don't have to sit and just stick to one way. You can explore so many different ways.
No,
the best thing is like you don't have to write a single line of code for that. Somebody's already done it. They've packaged it for you. Just go install the framework, check up on the module, install the module, reboot it, you're ready to go.
Is there any app which kind of works on like gestures also? Like if I do this, it should switch off or whatever?
Yes, I use a launcher called Nova Launcher. Okay, the paid version of launcher called Nova Launcher Prime. It supports gestures. So what I can do is I can swipe up. It opens a quick settings panel. I can swipe down. I can swipe down from here, from here, from here. It doesn't matter from where I swipe. If I can swipe it down from anywhere, it pulls down my notification bar. So if you're one with the huge screens, you don't have to use both your hands or you don't have to crawl your phone all the way like this up and then drag it.
Just work like an iPhone.
Sorry?
Just work like an iPhone.
Yeah. I know, I've not used an iPhone since past two and a half years, so I don't know how it is. Yeah?
Past two iPhones, after that, no iPhones.
Yeah?
It's not related to user and customization, but most Android users have this problem of applications in the background not closing and using up CPU.
Mm-hmm.
I will say that.
Is there any way where I can control that?
Absolutely. Actually, I'll get to that. We'll get to that later. There's something called Greenify. We'll talk about it later again. But just going on about Gravity Box, this is something Gravity Box adds. It's called Screen Record. So you can, you can just record your screen.
It comes with Nexus 5.
Yeah.
The latest 4.4.2.
Acha, but I need to do this. So yeah, what you asked was runaway apps. That's what they're called. So there's something called Greenify, which is
so
basically
the
like
most common advice that was offered was. Use
PK, Taskulous.
Don't use Taskulous. You are just making it worse.
Taskulous?
Yeah, people still say use TaskKillers to kill it. So what happens with Android is Android programs have a life cycle. They launch, they do some activity, they go to background. You should try to kill a task when Android runs it process again, or there are the applications themselves have background services. So when they see that the service is not in the expected state, they launch it again. So whatever task killer does is all of maybe 2 minutes worth. So don't use task killers. It's pointless.
So instead, you can use something called Greenify. Greenify is a much better way of hibernating apps. That's what Greenify does. Say I've chosen the Barcamp Bangalore app, and I just hit the snooze button, and instantly Barcamp Bangalore has been sent into hibernation. Once I use the app, you can say it's kind of like frost freezing.
If you use an application called
Apple mode.
If you use an application called Deep Freeze, there used to be an app called Deep Freeze, which what it does is Deep Freeze saves an application state and keeps it at that, and when you launch it again, it restores it back to that application state. That is what Greenify does. The problem with Greenify is your push messages will stop working, but the donation version of Greenify can make the app hibernate in such a way that it can still listen to GCM. GCM is the service which looks after push messages. So your app can still be hibernated, but you can still receive push messages. Yes?
Every time you have to go to the Greenify and snooze it, or?
No, you can
just
you
add
can
it to the list.
Schedule it for background, this thing, for background hibernation.
So once I exit from the application, every time it's
it will automatically hibernate it, yes.
But won't it again kill the battery?
No.
It actually saves the battery. It's only hibernating it. It's not
it's
like a task manager where you're killing the task.
It there.
Excuse me. Have you heard about AirDroid?
AirDroid.
Doesn't that do the same thing as Greenify?
That is
since
AirDroid.
When? AirDroid
clears your memory, and
AirDroid
all the applications in your memory.
Managing your app.
I don't know. AirDroid has been going through some pretty impressive changes. So we haven't checked AirDroid in the last few months.
Managing your stuff.
They were, but they are adding it. Everything but the kitchen sink.
The more number of applications you have on Android, the Android phone slows down. So
that's where you can install Greenify, right? So the apps which you don't use regularly, instead of letting them run in the background, just Greenify them, right?
So
you can have 100 apps.
Data?
No. Until you launch it again, the
it won't
application
launch.
Remains as it is.
So this is the module section of Expose framework. And as you can see, I want to tell you about this, all notifications expanded. So if you're using any Android system which is 4.0 and above, you get the expanded notifications, right? That is, you can read your notification without opening your app. So I really, really need that. So because of that, if you observe my notifications, which will just come up, they're all expanded. Any notification which comes up, if there are more than one, they're all expanded.
Usually the notifications are collapsed into a single line, right? You can manually drag them down and show it up. So it can be annoying.
Yeah.
By default, small things, I'm not talking, Expose is not something which you can make very large changes, but they're all small things which can help improve your experience.
Good luck, man.
Friends are always here to troll you around.
We knew this was going to happen, by the way. We actually spoke about this.
Yeah.
He was hoping it wasn't him, but then, okay.
Let's wrap up.
Yeah. So I'll just show you guys. You can go to downloads. All you need to do is just get the Expose launcher. Expose launcher framework. I'll be sharing with you the link. And download it, install it, and then you can just go into the app and download all the any modules that you want. There are more, there are hundreds. It's a community, it's an open source community. So you can download whatever you want.
So all of these Gravity Box, XUMR are in Expose?
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
Expose framework itself has a package manager, so you can go search it. It also notifies you if there are updates to that modules. So you can download the modules from there itself without having to go to Play Store or not. It's also
it's
so Nova Launcher, Exposed modules, go nuts, come back next park and make sure what you've done.
Guys, any doubts? Any questions?
All this will work on the 64-bit Android which is coming in a couple of months.
You should tell us. You're the guy who's got the 64-bit build.
Have you heard of Linaro? Has anyone heard of Linaro?
Yes.
See, he's running away. So all your Linaro builds are being tested by him. So if you have any problems with Linaro builds, tell him. Whether they will work or not, we'll know.
It will coming in a couple of months.
If it doesn't work, they'll make it work. So that's not a problem.
That's what I'm working on.
Linaro is...
the toolchain. The company which... they have some toolchains which improves the compilers, which compiles AOSP code. So.
Also, one last thing. If you're a little bit into privacy and all that, something called App Ops Exposed. So it's a great app. Gives you a list of what each app is using, what permissions each app is using, and it's a safe way of disabling that, or rather revoking that permission. So if you don't want Foursquare to, or rather the camera app to be using your location, just go into the camera app, revoke the permission, switch it off.
What is it called again?
App Ops Exposed. You'll find it in other things, sorry, Exposed. Yeah.
The source is XDA.
Yeah, it's all XDA, it's all on XDA.
Oh, okay. So all mods from the XDA forum are in Exposed.
Yeah, you can say that. Not just
not only
XDA.
That.
Yeah.
It's like,
you have any questions, you can approach me on Santosh. So he's 9_6 on Twitter. I'm Satya Bhatt on Twitter.
Yeah, I still need to understand this.
That will be a topic for the next barcamp. Why is 9_6 called so? So, if you have any questions, you can come ask us right away. So we'll be here at 6:30. Thank you.